The Lord. Shall we worship the Lord? Right where you're standing, I want you to talk to your Heavenly Father and ask Him to just cleanse you, to wash you, to keep you, to fill you, because we need you, Almighty God, to go through every single day. Oh, God, we want to thank you for your mercies. We want to thank you for your grace. Hallelujah. We have no strength of our own. We're merely sinners saved by grace. And it is because of your grace and your mercy that has brought us through. And so we're living this moment because of you. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for everyone who is here in this temple this morning, physically and virtually. And so, Almighty God, we confess our sins and we ask you for forgiveness. We ask, Almighty God, that you'll give us, oh God, our first love. That, God, we will remember the reason for living. God, we will remember to make you the center of our joy. Hallelujah. And so, Heavenly Father, I pray, God, that everything that will be said and done today will be done to the honor and glory of your name. We magnify your name, God, and as your people come to worship you, we pray that worshiping will be easy, that worshiping will be a lifestyle. Hallelujah. We magnify your name and tell you thanks. In Jesus' holy and precious name. Amen. Shall we praise the Lord? Hallelujah. We're going to sing some worship songs. Draw me close to you. Never let me go. I lay it all down. To hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire. You are my desire. No one else will do. No one else will do. Cause nothing else can take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace. Jesus, help me find the way. Bring me back to you. Shall we praise the Lord?
We give you all the glory. We worship you, O Lord. You are worthy to be praised.
Oh,
Hallelujah. Shall we praise the Lord? Shall we worship the Lord this morning? Hallelujah. We are going to be having a procession at this time. And so we will listen to the procession and then we'll continue with some lively choruses. God bless you. Hallelujah. Shall we bless the Lord? Shall we worship the Lord? I'm going to invite you to stand again. You got a little chance to rest. A part of that song says, I'm thanking you for life.
Yes.
Let me see the hands of those persons who are thanking God for life this morning.
Amen.
We're thanking you for peace and for peace of mind. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Shall we all stand as we sing some lively choruses? Hallelujah. I'm a glad pilgrim on my way, going to glory land. Jesus, my only hope and stay, holding me by the hand. It's such joy to understand things that I never knew.
Deep in my promise to the Lord, I'm going
through. Oh,
I'm here. What a wonderful feeling.
I'm a glad pilgrim on my way,
going to glory land.
Oh, Jesus, my
hope and stay, holding me by the hand.
Yeah.
It's such joy to understand things that I never knew. Keeping my promise to the Lord,
I'm going.
Protecting me from the heat and cold.
I'll do. name I see before them lay.
Morning. Hallelujah. Have you been redeemed? Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of Jesus. I know I have been, and I'm giving God thanks. Good morning again, brothers and sisters. This morning is Harvest Sunday, and we're under the theme, following in his footsteps, walking with purpose. And as you have seen, we have a beautiful presentation of what the Lord has done for our farmers, and we give God thanks. Let me hear you guys, just put your hands together and to give the Lord thanks for the harvest for the farmers. And as we celebrate, we said harvest is to celebrate, to give thanks for the crops which the Lord have safely harvested to us. It's symbolized by the scripture as God's provision for us and God's blessing for us, right? And for God's blessing for others. It is the gathering of things planted and a natural time of reaping in joy what has been produced during the year in an agricultural community. And we give the Lord thanks for what he has done. At this time, I'm going to ask Brother Hansen to come and open for us in prayer. Bless the Lord.
Shall we praise the Lord? Let us worship God one more time.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Let us pray. Father, we want to thank you this morning for bringing us here today. God Almighty, we pray that you may help us to worship you, to lift up your mighty name, to exalt your name above all names, O God Almighty, because your name is worthy to be praised. Father God, we thank you again, Father God Almighty, for woke us up this morning, clothe us in our right mind, and place on our top of on the foot on our grave. And so, Father, we pray that you may take control today. Let your spirit manifest himself among us. Let your spirit, O God Almighty, actualize upon us and be with us, O great God Almighty. Keep us under the shadow of your wing, great God Almighty, that when we stand, we can stand with the assurance that, O God Almighty, use with us. Hallelujah. We pray, Father God, that may cover us. Anoint us, O God Almighty, with fresh anointing. Let your spirit continue to be with us. Let your spirit, O God Almighty, orchestrate, administrate your purpose with us, O God, that we can lift up your name. Hallelujah. God, we pray, O God Almighty, for the furtherance of the service, the scripture to be read, the song to be sing. We pray, God Almighty, for your mighty word, that your, O God Almighty, servant will be delivering today. We pray, God Almighty, let your spirit, O God Almighty, be with us. Let he preach, O God Almighty, that he has never preached before. Hallelujah. Empty him, Lord, O God Almighty, that our soul shall be blessed, our soul shall be revived, and our soul shall be, hallelujah, lift up your mighty name. Thank you, God Almighty, for today. Hallelujah. Hasten the footstep of those who to come, and let your spirit continue to be with us. Have your own divine way today, God Almighty, through your son, Jesus Christ, holy name I pray. Amen. Hallelujah.
Good morning, church. Ah, thank God for redemption. Oh, Jesus. Our scripture reading this morning will be taken from St. John chapter 4, verses 28 to 42. St. John chapter 4, from verse 28 to verse 42. And I'll respectfully ask you to stand, please, at the reading of God's holy word. You found it? Say amen.
Amen.
I'll go ahead. Then, leaving her water jar, the woman went back to the town and said to the people, "Come see a man who told me everything I ever did. Could this be the Christ?" They came out to the town and made their way toward him. Meanwhile, his disciples urged him, "Rabbi, eat something." But he said to them, "I have food to eat that you know nothing about." Then his disciples said to each other, "Could someone have brought him food?" My God, said Jesus, "is to do the way." Sorry, "my food," said Jesus, "is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. Do you not say, 4 months more than the harvest? I tell you, open your eyes and look at the fields. They are ripe for harvest. Even now the reaper draws his wages. Even now he harvests the crop up for eternal life, so that the sower and the reaper may be glad together. Thus, the saying, 'One sows, another reaps,' is true. I sent you to reap that you have not worked for. Others have done the hard work, and you have reaped the benefits of their labor." Many of the Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. "He told me everything I ever did." So when the Samaritans came to him, they urged him to stay with them. And he stayed 2 days. And because of his words, many more became believers. They said to the woman, "We no longer believe just because of what you said. Now we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this man really is the Savior of the world." Here endeth a portion of God's word, which is already blessed. We say, amen.
we continue to worship. Hallelujah. We bless the name of the Lord. Welcome one and all, brothers and sisters, to the house of the Lord. And the house of the Lord is liberty. Let's continue blessing of harvest. We can be thankful for salvation, redemption, healing, deliverance, and favor. His provision, his protection, his guidance, his peace, his joy for our family and for our talents and our ability. It's a part of harvest. So we ought to be thankful. And the first mention of harvest was in Genesis chapter 8 and verse 22, when God made the Noahic covenant. Yes, that's the covenant with Noah. And he said, seed time and harvest will never cease as long as the earth remains. As long as the earth remains, we shall produce, right? And so we give God thanks for that. And the more important part is part of what Sister Farr has read in our devotion, that the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. This highlights the fact that there are a lot of persons who need to be cared for and brought to God. And we see where Jesus demonstrated that by the Samaritan when he had witnessed to her and she went out into the village and gave that. And so as we celebrate the harvest of food produced, we also need to be commissioned to win the harvest of soul. Bless the name of the Lord. At this time, our praise team is going to lead us into the devotional hymn, and that's the hymn, Bringing in the Sheaves. And that's hymn 109.
Hallelujah. Can we all stand? Sowing in the morning, sowing in the darkness, sowing in the noontime and the dewy leaves, waiting for the harvest and the time of reaping, we shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves.
Oh, we are bringing in the sheaves.
Yes, we are bringing in the sheaves.
We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves. Bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves.
We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves. Sowing in the sunshine, sowing in the sunshine, sowing in the shadows, very night a closed door, winter's chilly breeze, by and by the harvest and the labor ended. We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves. We are bringing
in the sheaves.
We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the
continue to bless the Lord. Hallelujah. And our second scripture reading is coming to us by Deacon Howard Perry, followed by Brother Lorenzo Williams with our announcements and welcome.
Hallelujah. Do we have a praise? It's time to read. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was? All right, we're going to stand and go to Matthew 9, verse 35 to 38. Find it on your phone or in the Bible, because we're all going to read loud and strong. Amen? All right, so nobody will be excused for not standing. Hold on to the chair. Hold on to somebody. Amen. When you find it, say, praise the Lord. No, it doesn't seem like everybody find it yet. 2 more seconds. All right, let's go. We all begin together. 35. And Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every sick among the people. He was moved with compassion on them because they fainted and were scattered abroad, as sheep having no shepherd. Then saith he unto his disciples, the harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he will send forth laborers into his harvest. And we say, thanks be to God. Amen. For the reading of his holy word.
Morning. Morning, brothers and sisters. It's Harvest Sunday, isn't it? And of course, there are so many scriptures that we can quote. For example, Psalm 95, verse 2 and 3. Let's come before him with thanks. Let's shout songs of joy to him. The Lord is a great God, the great King over all other gods. Let's give God a praise. If you're happy to be in church, give God a praise. If you're happy for your many blessings, give God a praise. I want you to jump up, man, and we're going to give thanks. We're going to do this one. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Glad you ever thought of me. Many are the blessings that you give unto me. Blessings are flowing like a mighty sea. Lord, I want to thank you. Praise and worship. Lively, let's go.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you ever thought of me. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you ever thought of me.
Many are the blessings that you give unto me. Blessings overflowing like a mighty sea. Lord, I want to thank you for your love to me. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you ever thought of me.
Breaks, praise and worship. Hold on, hold on. It does seem as if you want to give thanks and really thank the Lord that he has thought about you. Last week was Easter Sunday. Yes? We have so much, man. Church of God, get up and let us thank the Lord, man. Let's go.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord,
that you ever thought of me.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord,
that you ever thought of me.
To me, blessings overflowing like a mighty sea. Lord, I want to thank you for your love to me. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
One more time.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you ever taught me. The blessings that you give unto me.
Blessings overflowing like a mighty sea.
Lord, I want to thank you for your love to me. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
as we acknowledge the presence of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, give him a praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You may be seated if you can. To the leader of this August congregation, Reverend Dr. Knight, and his wife, Sister Sophia Knight, and by extension, Nathan and OJ, Reverend Jason Fullerton, and Sister Balana Fullerton, we welcome you. Permit me to also make welcome to our men's pastor and youth pastor, Marlon Thomas, and his wife, Dr. Mashon Thomas. To our councilmen and women, I welcome you and your families. As leaders, Hebrews 13, verse 17 reminds us that we should obey them that have rule over you and submit yourselves, for they watch for your souls, as they must give an account. Make them welcome. To our speaker for today, no stranger to us here at Old Harbor, Bishop Wayne Vernon. Sir, in Jamaican Creole, we will say, welcome, bless up yourself, and enough respect. To our musicians, Psalm 150, verse 4 to 6, reminds us to praise him with timbrels and dance. Praise him with stringed instruments and organs. Praise him upon the loud cymbals. Praise him upon sounding cymbals. And let everything that hath breath praise ye the Lord. Welcome, gentlemen. Thank you. To our praise team, Psalm 100 reminds us to make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands, and we should serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Praise team, you're sounding good. A special welcome to you all. To our ushers, as you meet and greet us each Sunday morning, you delightfully and warmly welcome us to this sanctuary. Be reminded of Ephesians 6, verse 7, that with goodwill doing service as to the Lord and not to men. Welcome to you, our ushers. To our moderator, choir members, children, and all other ministries and department members, I welcome you wholeheartedly to our service today. To our worshipers online and in the sanctuary, thank you for worshiping with us at Old Harbor New Testament. To you, our first-time visitors, please feel free to worship with us. Let not today be the first nor the last. You choose to worship with us here at Old Harbor. Are there any first-time visitors with us today? Visiting for the first time. I see two hands. Can you stand? Right, Old Harbor, welcome them, man. Give them a welcome. Thank you for making it Old Harbor. And please come again. If we have any unsaved among us, Isaiah 53, verse 5 reminds us that he was wounded for our transgression. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. Today is the day to say yes to Jesus. All to him I freely give. Welcome and thanks for joining us. Now that I have given you the welcome, I know at Old Harbor we're accustomed to our fellowship, Sunday morning fellowship. Not true? Meet and greet. It's a praise team. 3 minutes, a lively song with meet and greet, a handshake, a smile, whatever it is. You know, we've gone through the week, we need to give thanks. So you haven't seen somebody for a long while, give them a hug, give them a gentle smile. Praise team.
You're my brother, you're my sister. So take me by the hand. Together we will work until we come. There's no force that can defeat us. We'll walk in side by side. As long as there is love, we will stand. You're my brother, you're my sister. So take me by the hand.
We don't finish yet. The last time, and then we get back to our seats. Go.
You're my brother, you're my sister. So take me by the hand. Together we will wear until we come. There's no one that can defeat us. Walking side by side. As long as there is love,
full of love. You don't want to stop, hug up and kiss up and greet up, eh? There's a lot of love in this church. Now, before we get into the notices, let's congratulate the Children's Bible Quiz team who were placed third in the Bible Quiz competition. Big up, One Old Harbor. Yes, well done. Belated birthday greetings to those who have celebrated their birthdays last week. If you are celebrating birthday during the course of this week, can you raise your hand or please stand to be acknowledged? Right, there's our sister over there celebrating her birthday. And there's another lady around the back there to my right. My praise team will ensure that you will enjoy your birthday this week.
Happy birthday!
Happy birthday! Happy birthday to all of you! Happy birthday! Happy birthday! Happy birthday! Happy birthday to all of you! Happy birthday!
I hope you have a wonderful birthday and God's richest blessings on your special day. Now, congratulations to those who celebrated anniversaries last week. Are there any celebrating their wedding anniversary during the course of this week? Anyone? No hand? Rev, we need to do something about that. But I'm coming to that part, Rev. All right. General announcements. Now, senior ministry meeting will be held this Tuesday, April 9 at 10 a.m. Pastors and workers fasting will be held on Saturday, April 13, beginning at 6:30 a.m. in the sanctuary. Point Hill New Testament Church of God will be having its rally on April 19th, beginning at 7 p.m. Now, Brother Deron, it's that time, isn't it? It's that time. Don't see nobody rocking in. I wonder what's happening. Not true. Yes, man. All right, hold it right there. And although I'm doing the announcements, Rev, I want to ask the question. Do you have your minister's manual? You have your minister's manual. All right. Why I'm saying that? It's no time for retreat. But it might couple with it. It's retreat. Yes, man, retreat. Good. Thank you. All right, so Rev has his minister's manual. And if it was a ceremony, we need couples to go on the retreat. So I will volunteer myself to read the scripture. And it says, may your fountain, Proverbs 5, verse 18 to 19, may your fountain be blessed, and may you rejoice in the wife of your youth. A loving doe, a graceful deer, may her breast satisfy you always. May you ever be intoxicated with her love. Wow. Couples, it's that time. Retreat, not true? Yes, man. So we have everything here, you know. So if you didn't plan to go, but you plan to get married, Rev is here, he has his manual. And so you can book your spot. So it's that time of again for the marriage ministry retreat, which will be held at the newly refurbished Sea Gardens Beach Resort in Montego Bay. On May 31st to June 2nd, the cost for 2 nights and 3 days is $81,000. Cost for 1 night and 2 days is $46,000. We encourage all married couples to make your deposit and visit the table at the front of the church today right after divine service. We will have information on the trip and pictures of the location on display. Wellness Bay, we continue to pray for the following members who are experiencing health challenges. Sister Camilla Hewitt, Inez Brooks, Sandra Young, Mildred Roach, Lurleen Beckford, Natalie Reddix, Marion Peter Jones, and Brother Staffel Johnson. Reminders, Victory Fasting Service, Wednesdays at 10 a.m. in the sanctuary and on Zoom. Bible study, Wednesdays at 7 p.m. in the sanctuary and on Zoom. Prayer meetings, Saturdays at 6:30 a.m. Another reminder is that the ladies' ministry invites all ladies to their meeting on Saturday, April 13, 5 p.m. in the sanctuary. Now, Sister Knight is expressing thanks to all our members who assisted in making our regional women's convention a success. Yes, go ahead. Your ardent work did not go unnoticed and was highly appreciated. May the Lord continue to empower you as we continue in kingdom building. May I encourage everyone to participate in the E1B1 program, that is, each one bring one. Identify one unsaved person that you desire to be saved. Pray for that person, encourage and witness to that individual, and invite them to church. You have a spirit-filled week. Thank you.
We continue to bless the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. And just to highlight these persons that have chosen the Old Abba New Testament Church of God to worship. First-time visitors, Anneke Richards. Can we ask you to stand? Yes, she's over there in the white. And we have Shakara McLean visiting with us from England. We have Kimone Harrison. Is this Sharna or Lerner? Lawrence? Yes, she's holding up her hand. Yes, and we have Kahim Palmer and Camille White. So welcome, welcome to the Old Ava New Testament Church of God. And thank you so much for choosing this sanctuary to worship. And as they welcome, Brother William said, do not use this as the last time, but continue to come. At this time, we are going to have a special item from the missions and the lay leaders candidate. Let's put our hands together together for them as they come.
Take your candle, go light your way. Hallelujah. Bless the name of the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Take your candle. Go light your word. Hallelujah. We bless the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Now, an announcement. Brother Palmer is asking individuals to come out for a work day on April 3rd. That's Saturday, to clean this sanctuary, right? So we know that we have construction taking place, and Brother Palmer is asking, especially the men, we need you to come out this Saturday to help clean the sanctuary. Bless the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Now we are going to go into a part of the service where everybody can take part, and that is the offering. And so at this time, I'm going to ask Deaconess Harris to come and lead us into that procession.
Shall we praise the Lord, church? Let's praise the Lord, church. Hallelujah. Come on, church of God. Let's praise the Lord, church. Hallelujah. Bless the name of the Lord. Indeed, God has been good to each and every one of us this morning, one way or the other. We might not get our big money during the course of the week or any, you know, but guess what? He woke each and every one of us this morning, and we are thankful and we should be grateful for that. We are not in the hospital, so we are here to give, and we are here to give our very best to him this morning. Agree with me, church? Amen. Bless the Lord. Now, I'm going to ask a question, and it's not a rhetorical question, and don't feel bad about the question. I need an honest answer, and God wants you to answer truthfully also. I'm just going to ask you to raise your hand. Everyone who knows the Giver's Creed. We say it Sunday after Sunday, but everyone who knows it, all right, put down your hand. Let me say everybody who have ever heard the Giver's Creed, raise your hands. I expect to see more hands. Every Sunday we come up here and we say it. Okay then, I'm going to ask you to do something for me this morning. Turn your Bibles to 2 Corinthians 9, quickly. Every Jack Mandora. That's 2 Corinthians 9. Now, if you're there, let me get an orchestrated amen. No, some people are still not there. And I want you to mark this passage, okay? Today, it's a very important service, as this is what? No, come on, I don't sound like I'm a convinced man. What Sunday is it today? Harvest. And when we talk about harvest, what we do? We reap. And guess what? If you're not planting, you can't reap. Yes. So guess what? Each and every one of us in here, we are planters. And I want us to understand today why we plant, and when we plant, what we must expect, because we must reap. Now, according to 2 Corinthians 9, and I'm going to rush through it, but when you go home, just take your own a little time and go through it again, regurgitate and digest it. Our Giver's Creed this morning is, let me take it from the script. Giving is a grace, and we seek to excel in this grace as in other graces. We affirm that the tithes belong to who? God. For they work of? God. And we will not do what? God. Of his? Amen. We will stand on promise blessings. We affirm that he that soweth shall also reap, and he that soweth shall also reap. Amen. Every man, every woman, every girl, and every boy, as he or she purpose in his heart, let him give not, nor of, For God loveth a cheerful giver. And yes, very good. Clap yourself. Now, we're going a little bit further in that same passage. And God is able, verse 8, and God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that he always have all sufficiency in all things, may abound in every good work. Now he that ministered seed to the sower, both minister bread for your food and multiply your seed sown and increase the fruit of your righteousness. And we stop at 11. Being enriched in every good things to all bountifulness which causeth through us thanksgiving to God. Let us pray. Father, this morning we thank you. We exalt you. We magnify your name. You are God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, and you provided for us in every way. We are thankful this morning. We are bringing in, oh God, some it's monetary and some it's the produce, mighty God, of our own farms or whatever, Lord God, we purpose in our heart to give today. We are giving to you. We are not watching what somebody else is giving. We are not giving grudgingly, and we are not giving because there's a need to give. You have anointed us to give. You have blessed us to give. And so we come to give back to you that which rightfully belongs to you, Father. And we present our offerings this morning. And we pray your blessing upon it, Father. We pray for now, God, that these that are at the altar, Father, may your blessing be upon it. We thank you for those who would have given in this way. And Lord, right across, Lord, the areas of giving, today bless the heart of your people, we pray. And we say thank you for the bountiful blessings as we give, Lord God, not grudgingly, but we give generously to you, the giver. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. When I first began to walk with the Lord, I didn't fully trust him. Oh, how he longed for me to understand that I could. So through the valley, he leaded me, afraid as I could be, until his loving arms embraced me. Don't cry. Just remember, God is standing by. Hold on, wait, and when you have heartaches, don't cry. Just remember.
Hallelujah. So comforting to know that God is standing by. Hallelujah. We bless the name of the Lord. Is there a praise for our King of Kings and our Lord of Lords? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for standing by. We bless the name of the Lord. I want to thank you all for keeping up with me this morning. It was a blessing to lead today's service. I want to thank Brother Hansen, Sister Farr, Brother Howard Perry, Brother Williams for the announcements, Brother Sister Harris, and thanks for the missions and the lay leaders candidate for that item. Thanks, praise and worship team. And at this time, we are going into the blessing of the harvest, and Reverend Fullerton is going to come. And right after Reverend Fullerton is our host, Pastor Dr. Knight, who is going to introduce the speaker and the choir.
Can we praise the Lord? Come on, lift holy hands and praise the Lord, somebody. We praise God. My brothers and sisters, it is such a privilege and an honor to be here in the house of the Lord, especially on a beautiful day like this, the day of harvest, and we want to thank the Lord of the harvest. Somebody praise the Lord. I'm here to bless the harvest, but before we move into the blessing of the harvest, let me highlight the the meaning of the harvest season. And so the harvest season is a season of gathering grain and fruit on the 16th day of Abib, which is April. We recognize harvest in the month of April. A handful of ripe ears of corn was offered as a first fruit before the Lord. And immediately after this harvest commenced, it began with the feast of Passover and ended with Pentecost, which is next month, thus lasting for 7 weeks. A significant thing about the harvest season is that the harvest was a season of joy. So we don't need anyone to be giving of their best with any sad face. We're giving back to the Lord with thanksgiving and praise to Him. Somebody praise the Lord. And so, two significant things about the harvest season is that the harvest represents God's provision and God's blessing upon the work of His people. And another spiritual aspect is the work of Jesus Christ for mankind. When He looked at the multitude, He said, "The harvest is ripe, but the laborers are few." We are living in the harvest season, my brothers and sisters, hence the need of evangelism. So as we thank God for blessings, let us ask Him to send us out and to reap His harvest. I'm going to ask our ministers to join me at this altar and our officers as we bless God's provision and God's blessings upon this harvest. We praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Musicians, you can go ahead and string a beautiful string instrument as we go before the Lord with thanksgiving, honor, and praise. Hallelujah. Officers, you can join me at the altar. Continue to praise the Lord, everybody. Oh, praise God. We give you thanks, Lord. We give you praise. Somebody go ahead and worship Him. Come on, thank Him for your blessing. He's the Lord of the harvest. We want to leave today knowing that He is our Lord and He is the Lord of our harvest. If He had not blessed us, we would not have anything to give. But because of His blessings, we can give with joy. Hallelujah. Bow your heads with me. Father, in the name of Jesus, we give you thanks. We join with the songwriter in saying, thanks, thanks. I give you thanks for all that you have done. Lord, we give you thanks, O God Almighty, for blessing the first fruit of our labor. Lord God Almighty, whether it be monetary funds or whether it be by fruit, oh God Almighty, vegetables. Father, we worship you and adore you. Lord, we pray in the mighty name of Jesus Christ that as you bless us, God, you will cause us to be blessings to others. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus that your spirit, which is the spirit of harvest, Lord God, will rest upon our hearts and we will find the need to go out and reap, oh God Almighty, your harvest. In the mighty name of Jesus, Father, we pray, God Almighty, that just as all the laborers are few, Father, we pray for an increase in your kingdom, Father God, in evangelism, so that we can go out and reap the harvest that is plentiful in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we pray, God Almighty, for the laborers' anointing in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. So that, Lord, when we feel weary, the anointing that you place upon us, God, will drive us, Father, to do your work in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Father, we pray that just as how you would have blessed Abel's first fruit, fruit. You will bless our first fruit in the mighty name of Jesus. Cause us to see the fruit of our labor in the mighty name of Jesus. And as you would have promised us in Malachi, that you will deal with the devourers of our crops in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Lord, let your name be glorified. Let your name be exalted in the mighty name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. As your people lift holy hands to you, as your people lift holy voices to you and tell you thanks in Jesus Christ's name. Somebody shout amen and amen. Somebody shout a hallelujah to him. Shout a hallelujah to our God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I hand over to Bishop Donovan Knight. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Amen. Somebody praise the Lord in the house this morning. Hallelujah. Indeed, we give him thanks. We are so blessed. Where are the blessed people of God? Where are those who experience his blessings on a daily basis? Hallelujah. Every minute of the day, I am blessed. When I wake up in the morning, when I lay my head to rest, I am blessed. Come on, somebody, declare it in the atmosphere. Hallelujah. When I'm walking on the road, I am blessed. When I'm driving in my car, I am blessed. If I'm taking taxi, I am blessed. Hallelujah. Come on, church, worship the Lord. Worship the Lord. God, some people sit down as if their God is dead. Hallelujah. And they don't know what I'm talking about.
Hallelujah.
Amen. But if you woke up this morning, you are blessed. If you're still in your right mind, you are blessed. If you still walk, you are blessed. If you went to the bathroom this morning without any difficulty at all, you are blessed. Hallelujah. Come on, praise the Lord. You can still talk, you are blessed. Hallelujah. You put on your own clothes to come to church. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I am blessed. Come on, declare it in the atmosphere. I am blessed. I am blessed. I am blessed. And right now I'm blessed.
I am blessed.
Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Oh, glory to God, and be seated in his presence. Glory to God. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Greetings, brothers and sisters. It is good to be in church today. This is the day that the Lord hath made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Praise God. It's good to see all of you who have made it out this morning. I know we had a very packed week last week. We've been running this thing since Friday or Thursday last week, every day, back to back. And many were back in from Wednesday. We were in the pastors and leaders conference here, back at Congress on Thursday, Friday, and somewhere here up to last night, midnight, and back out early this morning. Good God, put your hands together for yourselves. You've been so well. Hallelujah. You have done extremely well to be here today. May the Lord continue to add his richest blessings over your life. I want to also endorse the welcome that was extended earlier by Brother Williams to welcome you to the Old Harbor New Testament Church of God, and especially to our first-time visitors. I want to say welcome to you. You have done well to make Old Harbor New Testament your place of worship today. God bless you. We are very happy. We are delighted to have you worshiping with us. It's our delight, brothers and sisters, our utmost pleasure to have with us today one of God's choice servants. I have known this gentleman since I was a teenager. Yes, I was a teenager too. Amen. Praise God. And he does not look one day older. Yeah. Him dying beard, but he doesn't look one day older than the day I met him when he came up to my home church in Cobbler to minister. And I was privileged now to sit at his feet at the Bethel Bible College when he served as my lecturer and as the dean of the college at Bethel. And there are some principles that I've learned from Bishop Vernon that I hold dear to this day. One of them, he said, guys, work with your strength. Guys, work with your strength. Forget your weakness. Work with your strength. And I held onto that to this day. What he was saying is to just focus on the positive. Focus on the positive. Forget the negative. And that has been, I've held that as one of my philosophies going forward. Work with your strength. And there are so many others that I've learned from this gentleman. Mighty, powerful man of God. And when he served as National Youth and Christian Education Director, I've had the privilege of working at camp and working in the youth department, you know, just being at his feet, watching him do things, learning from his leadership skills. And that has contributed much to the person I am today in the kingdom of God. And I must let you know that at one point I was his barber. Yes, amen. Bishop Wayne Vernon is the lead pastor of West Toronto Church of God and district bishop. He accepted the call to Christian ministry in 1983, at the age of 18 and a half, when he entered Jamaica Theological Seminary. He holds a bachelor's degree in theology, a master's in interdisciplinary studies from the Jamaica Theological Seminary and Caribbean Graduate School of Theology, respectively. He served as chair of the Regional Council of the Church of God in Ontario, Canada, as well as member of the National Council of the Church of God in Canada. In Jamaica, he served as academic dean of Bethel Bible College and dean of Jamaica Theological Seminary, Mandeville Extension. In addition, he served as National Director of Youth and Christian Education for Jamaica and the Cayman Islands. In Canada, Bishop Vernon served as Consultant Dean for International Bible College in Canada. He is the author of the book, Six Practices of Effective Leadership. And all of you should get a copy of that book. They are on sale at the national office. And he has also, and he is a contributing author for several other books. He leads Core Leadership Services, an organization committed to coaching, organizing, researching, and equipping persons for greater and future leadership responsibilities in order that they might be effective in the global environment. He also does a daily podcast at noonday. Reverend Vernon is married for 34 years to Yvonne. It would be good to have him on retreat with us, eh? 34 years. And they have two grown children and three grandchildren, two amazing girls and one adorable grandson. I'm almost certain that when he comes to us, to the pulpit, he will tell us much more about his grandchildren or his family. Just before Bishop Vernon comes to us with the word for today, we're going to be listening to the singing of our choir. They'll be coming to us with their ministry. And immediately following their ministry, we are going to stand and put our hands together and make welcome our day's speaker, Bishop Wayne Vernon. Let's have our choir.
Hallelujah. Serve the Father.
must labor at best. Well, the life devoted to our God, that devotion will be best. We work the field of souls, gather you and I. Some fields are blooming now, but other fields are dry. We are not the same. Differences aside, we will work the field of souls together, you and I. One is off to foreign soil to work a distant land. Oh yes, and another anchors close to home. Hold the neighbor's hand. Tell me who has served the Father most and who has labored best. Well, the life devoted to our God, that devotion will be blessed. We work the field of souls. Together you and I. Some fields are blooming now, other fields are dry. We are not the same, oh, but differences aside, we will work the field of souls. Gospel in the street for everyone to hear. Oh yes, and he's bold to everyone he meets, and his words are loud and clear. Oh, and another cries alone and prays in silence on her knees. Before the throne, day after day, her human eyes don't see. We work the field of souls, together you and I. Some fields are blooming now, but other fields fields are blooming now, while other fields are dry. We are not the same, oh, but difference is a sign. Harvest, for the laborers are few, but this is what Jesus has left for you and I to do.
Let's give the Lord praise. Give the Lord a hand of praise as we celebrate the fields of souls that God has given to us to reap. We give God praise. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. My brothers and my sisters, I am delighted to be with you today here at Old Harbor. Can you believe that it is 14 years since we left this congregation? 14 years now since we have left this congregation. And sometimes the congregation I pastor now in Canada hears so much about Old Harbor until it is embarrassing. And you know that churches are jealous, right? Yeah, so you keep talking about your previous congregation. It doesn't go down very well with your new congregation, but that's all right. Old Harbor holds a very special place in our hearts. Vonnie and I, we love this congregation called Old Harbor, and we look forward to coming back here. 20 years ago, while this congregation was at Darlington Drive, God gave us the vision to come to this place. And on that fateful Sunday morning, we each picked up a piece of furniture and we walked from Darlington Drive down here. And some people came to see what these idiots were doing, bringing stuff on their heads, chairs and whatever. And the musicians were down here and the praise team, they were already here. And we marched from Darlington Drive with the offering buckets, the microphones, everything, like idiots, and we came down here. When we got to this place, we were lost in this building. We made the aisles wide in order to look good, you know. But we had to bring in chairs, and we never had sophisticated line array boxes at the time and digital system. Some of the equipment, we made them ourselves. The huge bass bins, we made them. Gary and the others, trust me, they work hard in building those bass bins. And Lowell, we were flying speakers. See the chain still up there? We were flying speakers in the ceiling, and we never had lifts or anything to go up there to get them. These guys were amazing. Amazing. And I'm so happy to be here. When, in those days when you were preaching inside here, when you say, praise the Lord, the sound hit the roof and came back at you. The echo was so strong in the building. It was something else. But you know, and the heat coming from it was something else. But praise God, we came down here and cleaned out this place. We cleaned out more pigeons and more rats out of this place than you've ever heard. When we're in church some Sundays when we just got here, you got a blessing from above from the pigeons. We got rid of them and fenced the building, meshed the building, and they destroyed the mesh that we put up there and come back inside here when we were worshiping. It was a challenge to get the pigeons out of here. They had church with us inside here every Sunday. But praise God, look at what the Lord has done. We give God praise. We give God praise. It was a lot of work. In order to sterilize this building, we had to bring trucks inside here, you know. The trucks came through those shutters at the back, and we had to power hose this entire place because it was filled with pigeon dung and so on, and we had to sterilize this entire place from top to bottom and wash everything out with disinfectant before we were able to come inside here. It was a task, but praise God. Amen. I'm happy to see you. I have so much to reminisce about, but I got a word to preach. I want to greet Dr. Knight and his beautiful wife and family in the name of the Lord. It is good to be with you, my brother. And I tell people here at Old Harbor and everywhere else, you must learn to behave yourself and treat people good. You hear what I say? Some of you are born under some stars. I am not born under any, praise God. So I'm not a scorpion, so I'm not have no sting for sting nobody. I'm not a Virgo, I'm not a lion, I don't believe in the zodiac signs because I'm a Christian. That's who I am. But if you do, you can continue being ruled under there. But if you allow yourself to be ruled under these signs, the blood of Jesus Christ cannot change you. Because every time the Holy Spirit wants to change you, you remind him that I'm a Leo. I'm a Virgo. I'm a Scorpion. So this is how I am. I can't change. Treat people well no matter which month you're born. Because you never know. When I was teaching Bishop Knight in Bible school, I had no idea that he would succeed me in a pastorate. Yeah, I had no idea. And when he was studying there, if he was disrespectful to me, then, you know, I would have called you when I heard that he's been appointed here and said, listen to me, talk to Bishop because he's not a good man. You think I'm joking? No, I would have to protect the congregation. Yeah, but you treat people good, right? I tell you one good feel-good story, and then I will go into the word. You know, I see some lovely people who I love here at Old Harbor. I was going to pick on somebody, but I remember the last time I picked on that person. She said, Pastor Vernon, if you mess with me one more time, I'm going to sit on you. I mean, and trust me, when I thought about who was going to sit on, God bless you, Sister Palmer, I love you. So that was not a messing with you. I was just saying what happened. Praise God. But I'm happy to see you. So I tell you one good story and I'm going to go to the word. I pulled up at the airport, Norman Manley. I was heading out and this young lady, she said, the Reverend Bishop Dr. Wayne Vernon. Anytime I hear that, I know it's somebody who knows me and I'm a pastor, man, and people greet me all the time, and I don't remember them, and I have to do the polite thing. I'm listening to your voice while you're talking. I'm looking at your face, and I'm trying to remember who you are, and I can't remember who this young lady is. And she says, don't worry about it. I used to attend Old Harbor Church, and she told me who she used to attend with, and so on. So she said, so, Bishop, your seat number is whatever, and we're leaving from gate, whatever. And I said, hold on, my girl. Oh, you give me seat number and you don't ask me if I need a window seat or an aisle seat. I don't get it. She said, Bishop, it's okay. I'll see you at boarding time. And then boarding time, I was there. I heard somebody behind me, Bishop Vernon, may I have your documents, please? So I handed over my documents. And she said, follow me, please. I'm a step past everybody. And follow her, because she said, follow me. So I just walked past everybody and went with her. And I said, what's going on? She walked with me straight to the plane. So I said, I don't understand what's going on, but might as well. Of course. Then if I'm being escorted by an immigration officer, then why shouldn't I just follow? So I followed, and I got onto the plane, and she has my documents, you know. So I'm saying, I don't understand what's going on. And then I got into first class and she goes, went like this. This is your seat, Bishop Vernon. You've been upgraded to first class. Have a wonderful trip. She gave me back my documents and she's gone. You must treat people good because you never know what's going to happen. I'll talk with you about treating God good when in the sermon. But I'm so happy to be here, and I see so many familiar faces and so many strange faces. And you know, if I was afraid of eyes, then some of you, I don't know your faces, I would have been afraid of your eyes. But when I sat there, I look around and I know where my people are, so that when I'm preaching, I know where to look. And then I looked over there and I saw somebody who's supposed to be in Canada who is in church. And you never tell me, Frederica, that you were going to be in Jamaica. You see how life is? Good. Next time, don't do it. And I look over this side. Hey, brethren, you see, when you leave in Canada, you must report to your pastor. Because, see, I catch you, you know. I'm going to take a picture so that I have evidence. Good to see you, my brother. Praise God. And so many of you, it's so good to be with you. This church holds very great memories for us. It's a wonderful church. Old Harbor Church is a wonderful church. No, you don't believe it. And nothing can mash up this church. No, I'm serious about that. No. This church has a rich history, you know. It's not a church where just Johnny come lately, you know. No, this church has a rich history. I have some old people praying for you. So you see, when we hear like all some little things that pass through, little wind pass through, in my heart I know that you're safe. You're going to be all right. My father used to say, God bless you and keep you. And may he cheer you and keep your heart pure. All I'm asking you guys to do is to keep your hearts pure. It's God's church. And don't allow certain things to get under your skin. You hear what I'm saying? No, I'm asking if you heard what I just said. The church I pastor, can you let me share? The church I pastor, I got a big hit in my head just before COVID. A Nigerian pastor passed through and said to me, God sent him to come and help me. And so I have the bishop in the congregation, pastor, and I am... If anybody know me, you know, I utilize people, and I will get into trouble for that. And I'm involving the brother in ministry. We're doing hospital visits and all of them things. Somebody said to me, Pastor Vernon, be careful. And I said, no, man, the man is a bishop. What are you talking about? Pastor, take your time. And guess what, brothers and sisters? I am there pastoring the church. And one night I went to my bed. And I prepare my sermon to preach Sunday morning. I want you to hear me and hear me good, okay? I prepared the sermon for Sunday morning. And God wake me up before day and said one word to me. And I did not know the meaning of the word. I woke up out of my sleep with a word. Have you ever heard of people who they plant in an organization to find out things? It's called a mole. A mole. The Lord woke me up that morning. I'm going to preach the word, and he said to me, mole. And I say, I hear you, mole. Holy Spirit, what must I do with that? He said, mole. I said, but I didn't go to my bed thinking about mole. I don't know what it means. I don't know who you're talking. But the Holy Spirit would not stop harassing me. So I took up my phone and I Googled the word mole. And the dictionary says mole is a rodent that destroys your lawn, bores way under your lawn, and has a whole heap of holes and exits and entrances and so on. And then I read Sister Knight, and it says in an organization, a mole is a political operative that they plant in an organization, look like you, sound like you, work like you, but they are not like you.
you, they are working their way underneath and they are going to destroy the organization. Pastor, I jumped out of my bed, get my Bible and sit my little quiet self down. Listen to the Holy Spirit, what he was telling me. I put aside the sermon, Benji, that I had planned to preach. I went to church and I preach about the mole, not knowing who it was. And I preach it and lick it. And when I was driving home with people in my car, I heard my car phone ring. And when the phone rang, another Nigerian member of my church said to me, Pastor, do you know that Bishop so-and-so is splitting your congregation? And he has invited me and my family, and I told him, no, that's my pastor. And he hung up the phone on me. And that's when I found out what was happening. Long story short, I have set my timer to make sure that I keep in check, because I haven't been here for a long time, and I'll get, you know, excited and things. So I set my timer. Don't worry about it. Hear me, brothers and sisters. Some of the members of the congregation called me or came to see me and said, Pastor, you know, the Lord has said to us that we need to go with this person. And I'm being sensitive about your own situation. I'm only telling you my story, and I'm not interpreting it for you. So I don't want nobody to leave here and say, I am interpreting what has happened in this congregation. I'm only telling you my story. I'm not going to tell you. I'm put a period beside it, and I'm going to leave it right there. But I'm telling you my story, Bishop. It's a large congregation that I pastor, right? And guess what? People came to me and said to me, those of you who know me know how I preach. And people come to me, Sister Palmer, and said that they have to leave the church to go where they can be fed. Yeah. Pastor, when members come to you and tell you they have to leave to go where they can be fed, it lick you in your head, you know, man. It affects you, Sister Knight. But low blow, people who you minister, preach to, deliver, help, and they tell you they gotta go where they can be fed. And hear me, Pastor, I said to them, hold on, can you just give me 1 second, my sister? When you go through that door, you will no longer be a member of this church. I will no longer be your pastor. I'm asking you for a few seconds to tell you something before you exit my office, and I am no longer your pastor. I say, you see, when you go where you're going, just keep your 2 eyes open. I say, you heard what I said? I say, when you're going where you're going, keep your 2 eyes open. I say, is that enough for you? That's my only parting word for you. Keep your 2 eyes open. Long story short, after a while I start getting calls. Pastor, this is happening, that is happening. I say, I am not your pastor. I can't deal with it. A man and his wife come into my office and tell me all kind of demonic activities and witchcraft stuff happening over there. I say, listen me, I would not know, because I don't follow on YouTube, I don't follow on Facebook. I don't know where the church is located. I don't know. So you gotta tell me. And when they're done, tell me, Sister Palmer, I did not offer them a seat. I don't make them sit down, because they gotta get out of my office. And when they got out of the office, I ran upstairs to my secretary and said, the blood. I said, Colleen, the blood. I said, we have to blood up the church, blood up your office, blood up my office. I said, the blood. You probably think that this thing is a joke. But you know, I said to God, for every person, individual that leave, can you send me 5 families for each individual? Send me 5 families. You understand? For individual, I want families in return. I still pastor the second largest church in the Church of God in Ontario. And in January, we went to a conference in Atlanta, and the West Toronto Church is still among the 200 largest churches that the Church of God has in North America and Canada. Give God praise. I'm not saying that to you to boast. I'm saying to you that I got a big lick in my head. And I'm telling you, the people who were targeted, you know, man, was my best tight spears, my best leaders, my best people. Yeah, man, I'm going to tell you, say, Pastor, my belly hurt me. My tummy hurt me. When I see who I was losing, my tummy hurt me. But can I tell you, as I go to the word, that some people have taken their own little time and come back, and others have stayed home and whatever, and you know, the rest is history. And I saw the pastor recently, and he said to me that we need to talk. And he went to see Bishop Walker and asked Bishop Walker if he can have a little conversation between the two of us. I said, Bishop Walker, I don't do nobody anything, sir. So I said, if you will host the meeting, Bishop Walker, I will turn up. But it has to be at either your office or at a coffee shop. But it will not be at 1655 Wilson Avenue. It won't be at my office. No. A deceiver passed through. And let's keep it that way. I have no pain, no hurt. I'm a noise God church. I'm a noise God call me. So I never allow it to bother me after I get over the initial hurt. And I don't talk about it and I don't worry about it, because guess what? God has already dealt with it. Dr. Knight, God bless you, my son. I've been praying for you, praying for the ministry here at Old Harbor. You're going to be fine. Council ministers, everybody, I love you. Visitors, love you in the name of the Lord. And you know, the Old Harbor brethren can tell you, if Pastor Vernon say the time is going to be XYZ, that's what it is. I'm going to set the time already, so don't worry about it. The time is set. I've set the time for 1.5 hours. That can work. Anyway, don't worry about Pastor Vernon. He's just mischievous. And Sister Palmer knows that all too well, that he's mischievous. It will not be 1.5 hours, all right? Not at all. I have made sure to get you out. Those persons who have been asking me for my book, 6 Practices of Effective Leadership, you can check with the church office, and I'm going to tell them not to sell you at the regular price, because you are not regular people. So I'll fix that for you. Don't worry about it, all right? Genesis chapter 4 and the verse 2 and following. For the next few minutes, I'm going to camp there. And after church, I will meet the rest of you who I didn't get to hug yet. If I don't take pictures with some of you and go back, Sister Vonnie is going to harass me. She say, you must take pictures and bring them back. All right? Sister Palmer, Nathan, turn man, married and have children. Tony Bett, turn woman, get married and have family and have picnic. Pastor Vernon and Sister Vonnie are empty nesters. Glory to God. It's just the two of us building castles, man. I'm sorry that I can't come to you couples retreat, because that was a staple on my menu. But praise God. You must see Sister Vonnie how she look young and nice since we get rid of the children and now have grandchildren. Man, if I had known somebody said that grandchildren were so great, I would have skipped the kids and go straight to the grandkids. Yeah, I love the grandkids. When I'm greeting congregations, I don't talk about the kids anymore. I talk about the grandkids. But it feels good. You see, Sister Farmer, you see, when I'm in church and my grandkids run up to me up the front and say, Papa, Lord have mercy. It feels so good. Turn your Bibles to Genesis 4. Because if you don't get there, I'm not going to stop talking. And my timer has told me that the time is going. Genesis chapter 4, brothers and sisters. Today is Harvest Sunday, and I'm happy that I'm here on Harvest Sunday because I see some things that I'm going to pay attention to when I'm done, brothers and sisters. Can I just tell you what is in the text because of time and move on? Adam and Eve had two sons at this time. It's Harvest Sunday. Tell somebody it is Harvest Sunday. Adam and Eve had two sons. One was called Cain. He was the first one. The second one was called Abel, my brothers and sisters. The first one, Cain, was a man who planted the fields and he planted crops. The second one, Abel, he reared animals. But the Bible tells me, brothers and sisters, as I summarize what is there, that in due course, that Abel brought food and brought some of the stuff of his field to God as a gift to God. And Cain brought some stuff to God as well. But the Bible tells me, brothers and sisters, that there was a difference between Cain and Abel's offering to God that I want to share with you today on Harvest Sunday. My Bible tells me, brothers and sisters, that Abel brought to the Lord some fat portion of the firstlings of his flock. The firstborn of his flock, he bought fat portions of the firstborn of his flock and gave it to God. And when Abel gave the fat portions of the firstborn of his flock, God looked at it. God approved of it. God loved it. God smiled on it. God said, good, my son, go on, Abel. But when Cain gave to God, the Bible says, brothers and sisters, that Cain gave to God some of the fruits of his farm. I want you to see and God said, God despised it. God did not receive it. God did not approve of it, my brothers and sisters. Here is the difference, Pastor. And you can tell that I'm cutting things short. Here is the difference, Pastor. The action of both of them was an honorable. Both of them did an honorable deed. They brought something to the altar of God. They brought an offering to God. And both of them, their action was honorable, Pastor. And you may have brought this morning, you may have brought something to the harvest. And if you have not yet brought anything to this harvest, it is not too late for you to bring something to the harvest. You may not have food to bring. You may not have this or that. But I believe everybody in here has something that they can bring to the Lord and say thanks to God for what God has done for you. So when I was here and we were doing harvest, Jenny's had to come with her products. Mother C, where's Mother C? Mother C had to come with stuff from her boutique. Everybody had to come with something that God has given to you from which you earn a living and bring it to the Lord. Are you with me, church? Yes. Both of them, their action was okay. But hear what the problem is. Many of you have put offering in the offering plate. Many of you have put tithe in the tithe offering plate. Some of you have not. And you think you're smart, but it's okay. You interpret scripture in all kind of way. You tell me, Pastor, tithing is the Old Testament system. And we are under grace. We are not under law. I hope you know that under grace is rougher than under law. Because under law, it say bring 10%. Under grace, him say, each man, according as he has purpose it in his heart, let him bring it. The onus is on you to decide. So I stick with the 10%, you know, because that let me off the hook to have to sit down and work out. Because sometimes when I sit down and work out, God said to me, hey, give everything. So I run with the 10 just in case him say bring everything. You get what I'm saying? Hear me? Pastor, their action was okay. But hear what the problem was. The problem was their attitude, my brothers and sisters. You've got to understand that sometimes it is not your action that is the problem. It's the attitude with which you do what you do. That is where the problem is. What Abel did was to give God from the firstborn of his flock. And he gave the fat portion from the firstborn of his flock. It tells me, choir, that Abel was intentional. Abel was deliberate. Abel thought about it. Abel was purposeful. Abel did not just push his hand in his pocket and whatever was left from paying the toll, even the toll, the toll receipt, it gets into the offering plate. No, Abel was not like that. The man was purposeful. He was thoughtful. Are you with me, church? I'm almost done. He was purposeful. He was thoughtful. He gave to God something that he thought through, worked it through in his head, worked it through in his heart, and decided that this is what I'm going to give to God to honor God. He had a good attitude. If you don't have a good attitude to back up your action, you know, do you like when your wife or your husband, when you ask them, did you enjoy the meal? And them say, mm. honey, how does my dress look going to church? The frock look good. It can't go on. No, that's not what I ask you. You know? And we don't say, you look good in that outfit. We say, the frock look good. So what about me? Yeah. When we have an attitude, a nasty attitude, God knows that the action is not backed up with a good attitude. We did not think about it. It was not purposeful. We are giving it grudgingly. We are upset about giving it to God. And God was offended that after he had blessed, Lord God, after he had blessed Cain so that his farm produced, he gave seed to the sower and he gives bread to the reaper. After God had blessed Cain, my brothers and sisters, Cain took something from his farm and threw it and gave God. And God was offended. Offended by how Cain offered him. You give your gifts today. I hope you gave it with a good attitude, because you're not giving it to the pastor. You're not giving it to the church. And that's the mistake that many of you make. Right, my sister? Is the mistake that many people make, thinking that when they give tithe and offering and harvest gifts, that they're giving it to Pastor Vernon. And I'm saying, don't allow the fact that you don't like me to allow you to be rude to God and to be disrespectful disrespectful to God when you're giving to God. You give God and you have manners and respect. You give it to God with honor. Cain dishonored God with his substance, with his offering, and God was offended. Those of you who were here when I was pastor of this church, you would have heard this sermon before. I did a whole series in this church about honoring God with our substance. Sister Palmer was the treasurer of the church at that time. And when we ran the math and saw the average giving in the church, and when we came to the church and told the church that when there are 600-700 of us inside here on a Sunday morning, the average giving was pennies. When you did the math, can I tell you what happened? When we were done that series, the next month, I tell you, we got through the roof at that time. It was about $1 million, I don't remember. But guess what? Everybody realized that Sunday morning, we see a lot of people in here, and people sit in their seat and think that the many people that are coming up, oh my God, we must get $1 million this morning. But the average giving was pennies. Pennies. And when people started giving, man, Old Harbor Church became the fifth highest tithe paying church in the island during that period. Only Mandeville Church stepped past us by $20,000 for that year. I remember like it were today. Pastor, I'm telling you, when your attitude is right, your action will be right, brothers and sisters. And I might be yelling at you. I'm yelling at you without apology. Because, Pastor, we've got to tell our churches when people are doing the wrong thing and are hurting themselves, it is our responsibility to tell people and bless people. I can only tell you my personal stories. I went to the new church I'm pastoring, and I told them I wanted to bring in a youth pastor from Jamaica. And World War III broke loose that Sunday afternoon. Some people were even disrespectful to me. And I sat down and suck it up and said, Father, You know, hear how the person that just talked to me. You got left it, so are you gonna deal with it? Because if you don't deal with it, I have to deal with it, God. I'm gonna have to advocate for myself. Me can't make she dismiss her and get her with it, Paul. Father God, she can't leave the building. I mean, not deal with the thing. Father, me can't let her go. And Father say, you would sit down. Sit down, let me deal with it. And Father said, hey, you see when me deal with it? I go and dust her out, you see. I sit down at my seat, I'm listening to Pastor. And I'm there and I'm saying, you know, God, how you going to deal with it? You can't tell me how you going to deal with it. Because I would have want to know if you're going to deal with it right. Because me no think you know how to deal with these kinds of people. Them kind of people, your God, you have to deal with them certain way. Because them tough. So tell me how you're going to deal with it, God. Let me tell you if you're right. And God said to me, sit down. Behave yourself. I'm finished with the meeting, and my tail is between my leg, you know, Pastor. You know them thing that, and I'm walking. I'm gonna walk away to my office, and it's a long walk to freedom. You know, I'm walking to my office, and I pick up my things, and I'm walking away from the podium, and I'm dejected, and I'm mash up, and I'm saying, God, I want to deal with the thing. And I said, don't deal with it. And I thought that she would have dropped down dead already, and I'm waiting. And I'll know you don't move, and I have to leave here. No, leave that alone. But guess what? People started coming up to me, Sister Knight, and said, Pastor, don't let nobody fool you, Pastor, and don't listen to them. Whose name must I write the check in to support this pastor that is coming? Yeah. And I said, hold on, what you say? I said, write it in the church name. And one lady said, Pastor, don't listen to anybody and don't let them get to you. Because guess what? My husband and I, they do business. My husband and I, our contribution is going to be XYZ for the next 1 year so that you can can bring in this pastor. I'm going to say, what is that? And then other people came coming and my phone going off and people sending me texts and everything, Sister Palmer. And I'm saying, what is this? By the time I got home for dinner, my treasurer called me and said, Pastor, something blew up inside here. I said, what blew up, my brother? Him said, Pastor, you are here. How much money we raise since you finished the meeting? And I said, talk to me. And him tell me how much we raise. And I said, you're not talking the truth. He said, yes, Pastor. I turn up at church Saturday morning for early morning prayer meeting. We finish, Pastor. And a lady said to me, Pastor, whose name I must write the check in, sir? I'm going to say, write it in the church name, no man. And she just put up a check on the wall and just write it, slip it in an envelope, and gave it to me. And I said to her, don't move. She said, what happened, Pastor? I said, I want to see how much you put in there, because if it is not enough, I'm giving it back to you. Straight up. She said, Pastor Vernon, how you give trouble? So why are you like that? Just behave yourself. No, I said, don't move until I see it. Pastor, when I open the envelope and look on the check, me have to take my glasses off, clean it and see. Because there are number zeros. So I say, no, what is this? Oh, what you do with someone? When me look on it, Sister Palmer, there were $10,000 written down upon the check. Hey, listen to me. You see, after you are dejected and you have your tail between your leg and something like, God said, let me deal with it. And God deal with it. Hear me. Hey, you see, when me come out, Benji, me a speng. I'm a speng. God, watch me. Oh, come on. So hear this now, Tedia. God said he was going to deal with that person and we must leave it alone, let him deal with it. Sunday morning, I was able to go to the church, Pastor, and said, well, church, as I told you, we're going to bring someone in from Jamaica as youth pastor. Well, after the meeting on Sunday, some of you did an amazing thing and you have blessed this congregation. I want to report to you, what is the status of, you know, the finances? Oh, Jesus, Pastor. I say, I feel good, you see. I was able to say to the church, listen to me good, we have raised 1 year's salary and the man foot not reach on the plane yet. And we raised 1 year's salary. God of mercy, hear me. Well, Sister Palmer, I walked in with like a peacock with two tails, because God said, let me deal with it. You don't throw the egg, let me throw the egg. Hear me, I will handle this for you. I left it with God, and God handled it. And for 2-3 years, we never had to take money out of treasury to pay the youth pastor, because guess what? People committed. Until this day, my wife and I are still paying what we promised that time, because God said, I will deal with it. What is your attitude? I soon finish, Pastor. Yeah, I see it. Brothers and sisters, can I tell you something? Sometimes it has nothing to do with your ability to give, you know? Hello? Why did you go quiet on me? You know why it has nothing to do with your ability? It is because a widow said to the man of God that all I have left is a little oil, a cruse of oil, says the King James Version. I'm gonna bake a little cake, and when I'm done eating it, my son and I are going to die. I would have expected a sensitive man of God to say, no, my sister, you will not die. No, the man of God said, I hear you. That that you're going to eat the last and die. But hear what I'm asking you to do. Bake me a cake first. Out of that which you're going to eat and then you're going to die, bake me a cake first. Oh, God Almighty. The woman, her attitude was good. She baked the man of God a cake to sustain him. And when she was done, the man of God pronounced a blessing from God upon her and says, as long as this famine lasts, you are going to have adequate amount. When God was done blessing this widow woman, she became an investor. She became an entrepreneur. She had oil to sell, and God told her how to manage her business. Some of you don't know how to manage your business, but I leave that for your pastor. Here is the principle that the Holy Spirit gave that woman. Use a little for yourself and sell the rest. Some of us use the rest and sell the liquor. You can't make life that way. You're going to mash up if you do that. The attitude was wrong. The action was good, but the attitude was wrong. It had nothing to do with his ability. He earned. He had enough to give God, but he was not purposeful about it. He was not thoughtful about it. And I'm saying to us, let us be purposeful. Let us be decisive. Let us be deliberate about that which we are giving to God. I'm going to wrap this up by saying to us that their action and the attitude with it, for Abel, it gained God's approval, but for Cain, it gained God's disapproval. Are you with me, church? Are you with me, church? Are you with me, church? Understand that it is God that has given you the strength to be able to work your job. Whether you're a carpenter, whether you're a tailor, whether you're a taxi driver, whether you're a seamstress, whether you're a hairstylist, or you're a farmer, it is God that has given you the strength to do your work and to get a paycheck. You've got to have a proper attitude to your material possession. If you don't have a proper attitude, you will lose it, brothers and sisters. I've never seen somebody who gives to God and God allow them to suffer. Never. Cain experienced God's disapproval. And here is what God said to him. God said, Cain, come here, let's talk. God said, let me ask you something. Why are you angry? God said, Cain, why are you angry? If you had done the right thing, you would have gotten my approval. You would have gotten my approbation. Cain, why are you upset? You did something wrong, Cain. You disrespected me, Cain. You dishonored me, Cain. And because you dishonored and disrespected me, you are going to have to pay for it. Hello? When you go home, read the text. Pastor, God said to Cain, Cain, your life is going to be miserable. God said, Cain, you are the firstborn. But guess what? Your brother has moved up one notch because of your dishonor and disrespect. You have earned my disapproval. Old Harbor Church, can I talk to you today? I beg of you, when you're giving to God, don't be grudging, because God loves a cheerful giver. Don't give it out of necessity. Pay attention to your attitude. Pay attention to what you're giving God. Be purposeful about it. Be deliberate about it. Be intentional about it, because God desires respect and honor. God desires for you to honor him and respect him. Are you with me, church? Told you I'm almost done, and I'm almost done. My brothers and sisters, the high privilege of being the firstborn was ripped apart from Cain because of his disapproval. God did not appreciate what he did because he did not appreciate God, what God did. Can I talk to you? And I, my timer says stop. Pastor, we've got to pay attention to some character flaws that some of us have. Character flaws are dangerous. Because it doesn't matter which church you go to, if you have a character flaw, it is going to show up. Are you with me? Character flaws. You can change job as much as you want. Character flaws. You can change partner as much as you want. Character flaws. Them girls going figure you out. It only take them a little time to figure you out. That you have told them so many negative things about the last woman that you were with. But listen to me. It only takes her 2 months, 3 months to find out say, what you would say the woman say about you is true. Yeah, you get silent on me. Same thing with men. Yeah, you know what the statistics show? The statistics show that people who are divorced end up marrying to the same person 2 and 3 times. You marry the same personality because there is something in you that allow you to go after certain people, and you will end up in the same situation if you don't pay attention to it. You will end up in it over and over because there's a character flaw. There's something in your life that allow you to be attracted to losers all the time. We're not going to talk about that today. Cain, my brothers and sisters, had a very bad attitude, and it led him to anger. But more than just anger, Pastor, it led him beyond anger. You know, there are a lot of people in families and so on. When they see how God blessing you and when they see how God doing things in your life, they have all manner of evil to say, you know, Pastor. There are a lot of people who, when they watch how God bless people who give to God and who sow into the kingdom, who work in the body of Christ, they get upset with you. You don't need to be upset with me. When you were snoring, I was at church. When you were cussing about giving $10, $10, you know. When you were cussing that the concert at church is too expensive, you know we are trying to make some money for the entry for you out there. We not charge you. No, we just give you an opportunity to forgive. And you're fussed that it is too expensive. You know what offends me, Pastor? Let me just lick it. Come, he used to pastor this church. Let me just lick that hand up. Every time we talk about harvest and giving and stuff like that, let me go in the center right here. Every time you talk about those things, people say, Pastor, you have to remember that there are some people in the church, you know, sir, who are not earning and who can't manage. You have some single mothers, Pastor, them do even have dinner for this evening, you know, Pastor. And we collect offering last week and we'll collect this week again. Pastor, we need to have a little mercy and we can't be like that. And I say, you know, say a true your talk. But can you just ask the single mother them who are complaining and the old brethren them who cannot manage? Can you ask them to come see me right now? Then, Pastor, the people are saying, I say, you can't just bring the people them, the enough people them that are saying. You can't just bring them for me now. Let me apologize to them. I say, how many people complain to you? Well, you know, Pastor, there are many people. Then just bring them now. I just want to see them. I want to talk with them. Hear me. You can't stay there talk about the older brethren and so on. The older brethren, them know how to give. Them people, they don't cook little food. Them cook for them and the whole community. When they are giving in church, God love the old people, them giving, because the old people, them give. Them little $10, them little $1. But it is what they can afford to give, Pastor. And when they give it in love. And they store it above. They give it with a willing mind. They have a good attitude. You talk for yourself. Don't talk for the old people them and the single mothers them. They let them talk for themselves. Yeah, did I say I was almost done? It's a bad habit of pastors, but I'm almost done. Believe me. Let me take up the time because I don't want to look at it. It say you're done long time. So let me put it inside here. And let me just get out of the way. Pastor, can I tell you as I leave this congregation that where this thing led Cain to? Cain was angry with his brother. And God said, why are you angry, Cain? But not only was Cain angry, Cain became deceptive. He said to his brother, let us go to the field. Him don't know, so him have the knife hidden in his pocket that he was going to kill his brother. And that's where, brothers and sisters, look what grudgeful giving lead to. You see what grudgeful giving lead to? It led to murder because he was upset that God bless his brother and God said, I am upset with you. When you're in the church, my brothers and sisters, I beg of you, let your attitude to God be one of generosity. Give what you have purposed in your heart. When you come to harvest and you give something, don't just stop at the market and buy a little dry up pump and bring it to the altar. When you go to your field to reap it, don't just do whatever you do. You must do it with purpose. Some of you in this church, I don't know if you're still saved. I don't know, because I leave here 14 years ago. But you used to be good people one time. You have some people inside here, Pastor, and if you don't know them, when service is over, if them don't bring the cow calf and the pig and the chicken, talk to me about them. I go call some name to you. And if you don't see the pig and the chicken over there and the goat, you know, just talk to me afterwards and I will tell you who's supposed to bring goat and who's supposed to bring chicken and who's supposed to bring pig. Me know them people there. Me know them. You know, people would come to me, Pastor, and say, Pastor, this is the pig I was raising for harvest. Lord have mercy. This is the goat I was raising for harvest. They have purpose in their heart. 1 year ago, they started to raise their chicken and their this and their that. I know the people them who used to do that. And I can tell you, bring the book, come after church, and I will write it down and tell you. I see some of them writing at the front of the church, Pastor. Them used to bring pig and goat and chicken and all them things there, and they raise it 1 year ahead and bring it and say, I was rearing this for harvest. If them stop doing that, Pastor, call me and let me call them, because I have some of them number and I can call them and ask them, where is the goat? If you haven't brought the goat over the last 5 years, bring the five of them come, and the five pig and the how many chickens, because guess what, your purpose in your heart that this is what I'm gonna do. And it takes you 1 year to fulfill that because your purpose in your heart. My brothers and sisters, I love you so very much. But I got to tell you that God, if you're looking for sympathy from God, for giving to God, you can't get sympathy. Brother Jennings, what how you do? Can I hear this, Brother Jennings? God had one son. He never spared that one son. He gave his one and only son. And he did it generously. So when you cry, say, boy, God, the one I have, him say, me understand. Because me did have one son, and me give him. And guess who get him? You. And you. You get him. And you think you were deserving when you got it? No. You weren't deserving. So when I ask you for something, it's okay to give. The one. My mama had one boy, me. And she was 42. And she was having issues. And she tell God, say, God, anyhow you make the baby live, I gonna give him to you. You hear me? And my mama, when I was born, a few months after I was born, she had to do hysterectomy. And she had to do mastectomy within 3 months of each other. They found cancer in her breast. She had to remove it. She was struggling with fibroids in her womb and they had to remove it. 3 months within each other. But she had made a pledge. And when I told my mom some of the struggles I was going in ministry, and I said to her, Mom, it's your fault because you gave me to God. And she said to me, that's why I may have to pray for you so hard. I thought she would have joined me and said, yeah, man, them people, they're wicked and church, this and that. She said, it's okay, son. That's why I may pray for you so hard. Go on back. Mama, you know, help me talk them. You know, help me tell God. Say, God, kill two of them for me, please. Mama said to me, boy, that's why I may pray for you so hard. Jesus, what a wicked woman. Yeah, she said, so pastor, 18 and a half years old, I turn up at Bible school with my mama's milk on my top lip and can't explain to people why I'm in Bible school. 18 and a half. At that time, I was just looking around the church to see if I say any nice young lady who would like me to. You understand? 18 and a half. Hormone just a run from here to up here. So. Hormone just a float and your head space not where it is supposed to be. You're in church and you're focusing on Jesus and you look up on the choir and you first say, hold me, Jesus, hold me. You look in the audience and you say, Jesus, touch me. You know what I'm saying? And you just have to pray your way through and thing. And at that point, God called me and said, go Bible school. Sister Knight, I ended up at Bible school and there were days when I said, God, just tell me what you call me for now. I just want to know, sir. I want to know what you call me for. I wasn't the evangelist preacher like Pastor Knight. I was a kind of teacher and it's in a Pentecostal church. So me wasn't so accepted. You know what I'm saying? I was having struggles. Yeah, man, I try preach. And one time I try preach like Reverend Blair. One time I try preach like Bishop Beeson. One time I try preach like this. Me, I try come here, try see. May I try find myself and see if I can preach. I now find no traction. Because when I take off the jacket, I don't know how to wheel it. And when I kick off the shoes, I don't know how to kick it off. And when I do, me no know, because it's not my armor that. Is the armor too heavy for me? It's not that armor. But brothers and sisters, when I found my place in God and found a rhythm in God and God started to use me for his honor and his glory, him just bust me out and do what he wants to do with me and lead me. One at a time, Sister Palmer, you were the clerk of the church. You gotta tell Pastor that for 3 Easters, we baptized 50 people one time. Outside there, 50 in the metal tent. We went out to church pen and we baptized 50. And one next time we baptized 50. 3 years straight, we were baptizing 50 people in one baptism, 3 years straight. How many of you were here when we did that? When we had the pool over there and we have watch night service and start baptizing in the night. And when morning come, we still are baptized. Same way. And when me tired and can't baptize no more, Hugh Robert says, all right, Bishop, I will go in the water. Robert Edwards inside there, we are baptized people. Pastor Lal, when we out church pen, I'm a baptized till me weak. Lal say, I will take over. 50 people, Pastor, under the tent out there. 150 in 3 years, and we're baptizing inside here. Every month, Mother Johnson come, Bishop, I got 3 to be baptized, you know, because she used to teach a Sunday school class Seekers class, and Sister Johnson just keep coming with the 2 and the 3 to be baptized, and you just dip them and baptize them and let them go. And the church of the living God here was growing and growing and growing. If you continue to serve God good, if you continue to make your contributions, if you continue to have a good attitude, you will not have to become angry when you see God bless other people. You will not have to become deceptive, and you will not have to become murderous when God bless other people. You can rejoice with them because you know that your change is coming. You know that your blessing is on the way. Pastor Vernon got his, but mine is coming. I love to tell stories because Jesus loves to tell stories. And I'm going to end with this story. Pastor, I left this congregation, beautiful, wonderful, Old Harbor Church. Me said the music turn up. Me said the choir turn up. Me said the place nice, man, and the church a run. Me say, when Robert Edwards come up here, come lead praise and worship Sunday morning time, my God, man. You fall by your knee and inside there. That time all some people who must sit on the front row right now used to sing on the praise team one time. Yeah, man. Used to all lead the praise team in a them time there. I don't remember that person that I talk about. I don't look over so. You me we point and you wink your eye. Yes, you get it. You know who me talking. Leave it alone. Leave it alone. No trouble it. Leave it right there. Leave it right there. Not too evil. Leave it right there. But pastor, I tell you, I am pastor in the church. We're baptizing 50 people 3 years after. I mean, we became one of the fastest growing churches, pastor. I'm going to sit down in that office round there. I'm going to hear the Holy Spirit say, you're made for more. You got to go. Yeah. I'm going to say, what is this? Went home and I told my wife that the Holy Spirit said, you're made for more. And she said to me, well, prepare a sermon on it. I'm preaching. I said, this is no sermon. Mm-mm. I said to her, you know, so I'm going to get marching orders. And she said, well, long story short, pastor, I end up in Canada with the marching order, right? And I go to Canada with my dulcimina. And when I came off the plane that Saturday afternoon, I look left, right, and I look center, Joseph. I don't know where I'm going. I don't have no church to go past. I don't have nothing. And I bring my wife and my two children. She give up her job, resign, me resign, and turn up there. Me hear say, all some people at there, Jamaica, and them I laugh and ask my kids, say, is it true that your father is pastoring a little church with 25 members? And my daughter called me and I cry. I said, just love it, man. Don't make certain people get under your skin. Leave it alone. And then when Bishop Walker sent me to the little church, 101 east of Toronto, and when I go out there, Frederica, and when I see the little church, my belly hurt me. It can hold 70 people maximum. All when you put people on the choir and put a man around the piano, it can't hold no more, 70. And when it holds 70, if the police pass through, we in a trouble. Because we are, you know, what you call it? Regulation and ventilation, poor and all them things. I'm a pastor, I'm a little church. And then Sister Palmer, you know, say, me have one like a mad streak. My mother have me when she was 42 years old. So me never come out to write it, you know, and so on. So pastor, I am kneeling down in the church praying and the Holy Spirit say, you know, say, you can't stay here, so. No, man. Eagle can't live in a foul pen. You got to get out. Yeah. 3 months after I got there, Benji, I tell the elders that, listen, we got to go. It looked like me have a little going spirit in me. Because same thing we did when we were up at Darlington Drive. Yeah, man. And the Holy Spirit said, you got to go. I'm going to let you guys go now. So guess what? I'm praying and I say, God, what I must do? Pastor, the living Holy Spirit of God, give me a series of sermon. You have wandered in this desert far too long. Turn and go north. And I left the office, Sister Palmer, after church one Wednesday, fasting, and I said to Vonnie, let's go north and see where the Holy Spirit say is up there. Never been up there before, new community. Pastor, when I go up there, I said, Jesus have mercy. Holy Spirit, how you stay? So I see some big house, I see some new houses, I see house I built, I see this, I see that. And I said to my wife, my God, I want to live in one of them houses right over there. So up here, so look like a here, so man for live. Up here, so look like a, no man, downtown of the hood, man, downtown of ghetto. Me nah stay down there. Me come on. I went to the church and said, the Holy Spirit said, turn and go north. World War III break out. And I said to one of the deacons, after church Sunday, we're going to do a convoy. I want you to lead a convoy. Because some of them people here don't know where not Oshawa look like. Carry them go up there. When we go up there, people sit them say, Lord Jesus, we used to come pick cherries and grape up here. How up here so develops a pastor? We never know. Sister Palmer, we sell a little building, move into a schoolroom. Every morning we have to carry the boxes, carry everything in, and when we're done, we have to tear down and bring them out. And one deacon said, Pastor, I work at night, but when you come church Sunday morning, the boxes will be in there. Don't worry your head. And listen to me, we went inside there. Would you believe me, sir? The first Sunday we move in the schoolroom, the church grew. Some people here say one church over the school and come look what's happening. And some of them are still there until today. Long story short, that church is now a district church, Pastor. Yeah, man. Have them own property and all them things there. Lord Jesus, when God I got bless you, yeah. Me say. And then now, Sister Palmer, the last part of it is that me buy the property in November. Buy one house in the very area that I say I wanted to buy the house. Buy that now. And things say, all right, me ready for a cruise to retirement now. Yeah. I went to a meeting and Bishop Walker, who used to pastor this church, tell me, Pastor Vernon, we have to move you. 3 months after me buy the nice property, you know, man. Me say, apple tree upon the property, pier, this, that. Them have one apple tree upon the property. We have 4 different apple upon it. Them engraft it. And Pastor, me nice place where me drive up. And when me drive up, me can all just come out and just, you know, okay. Pastor Palmer, come on. Pastor Walker, come over there. Look at it and said to me, boy, we have to move, you know. And I said, where you move, my God, Pastor? And him said, West Toronto. And I said, do Bishop, not do it. But you know, he was moving me to the second largest church in Ontario. From one of the smallest to the second largest. And can I tell you, Pastor, I saw anger. I saw hate among even my very peers. Anger and hate. But I'm telling you as I walk away from this podium today, that if you have the right attitude when you do what you do for God and bless God and honor God, when God is turning it out on you, some people are going to be angry. Some people are going to be upset. Some people are going to be mad. Cain killed his brother Abel because of the blessing that God had said he was going to bestow upon Abel. And when God asked him, where is your brother? Rudah out of order. Ask God again, am I my brother's keeper? You know, see, same have some little manners issue. Disrespect God again, am I my brother's keeper? And God said, let me tell you something. Your brother's blood. Brother Jennings, your brother's blood cry out from the ground to me and say, why God, my brother, kill me? Abel had such a relationship with God. God said, the man, blood, cry out. And say, you know, she said, the man kill me, God. Jesus have mercy. Stand with me, church. Stand with me, church. Stand with me, church. Stand with me, church. Pay attention to your attitude. It's not just your action, but your attitude. You may have brought a gift today, but you never brought it in the right spirit. You never bring it with the right attitude. Can I ask you to fix it before the day is done? Fix it, man. Sort out yourself, man. You have opportunity to sort out yourself. And you need to, if you gave today and you know that you didn't do the right thing, and when I was preaching, something prick you and say, I should have done better. Hear me, Pastor. Me used to pastor this church. Me know some of them people are pastor. Let me deal with it for you. Listen to me. I don't even want an offering bucket. When me done this prayer, if you know that you have not done what you're supposed to do, and the Holy Spirit talking to you. If the Holy Spirit is not talking to you, you know, and you're ready to go home for your rice and peas and chicken, you know, it's okay. You can go. It's not you I'm talking. It is the persons that I know that the Spirit of God is talking to right now. When I'm done this prayer, I'm going to wait on you at the altar. The pastor never asked me to do it. I came here to speak at Congress, not to come to this church. So hear me, brothers and sisters. If you want to fix something this morning, nobody has to know what you never did right. I only want it to be fixed today. Because our attitude... Cain just threw something, gave God. Abel gave fat portions from the firstlings of his flock. Heavenly Father, we bow down to you. We thank you for blessing us so much. that we even have to give to others. We thank you for blessing us so much with your son, Jesus Christ, who has given his life. Today, Lord, as we come to this harvest service, we pray that you'd help that our attitude would be consistent with our action, and they too will be consistent with what your word requires: generosity, purposefulness, a good heart, an attitude in giving. I pray over this blessed congregation that has been giving over the years and have been worshiping you in harvest. And though this year may not be as fruitful as last, but I pray that as they have an opportunity today to fix the attitude part, and for those who need to fix the action part because they did not act by giving earlier, I pray that those hearts that you're speaking to, that they will respond right now. And those who do not know you as Lord and Savior, you who gave your only son in order to redeem us, I pray that they will choose to surrender themselves to you today. I thank you and I praise you in Jesus' name. And all God's people say, amen. With your heads bowed and your eyes closed, is there one person in here who has never surrendered your life to Jesus Christ before? Here is an opportunity. Can you just raise your hand? Not going to call you to the altar today. I'm just going to pray for you right where you are. Is there one you want to surrender to Jesus Christ today? Is there one person you've never surrendered before, but because of his gift and his sacrifice, you want to surrender? If you're here, I want to pray with you. If you're not, then it's okay. Father, there are people in this building who do not know you as Lord and Savior, but they are so bound by the enemy that they could not release themselves to receive your salvation. I ask you in the name of Jesus to minister to them. I pray that you would go home with them, Holy Spirit, and cause that they would recognize that you want to do a work in their lives and that they will surrender and return to be baptized. We bless you, we praise you, and we honor you in Jesus' name. And all God's people say, amen. Keep standing for me, please. I'm going to allow your pastor to come or your leader to come and release you. But if when I was preaching, you felt that there was something that you need to do, I'm not asking you for something for myself. I'm asking you for something for you. If you felt led, if you don't fuss about it. Don't worry about it. But if you feel that there's something you need to do, I have a minute to wait on you to fix it before the pastor comes. Is there one person who want to do it now? You want to walk here? Yes, I see some people coming. Yes, yes. Yeah, just put it down right there. The wind won't blow it. Yeah, leave it. Somebody will come and get it. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for being obedient. Thank you for being obedient. I see some obedient people. Our attitude. Just put it down right there. We get it. If it blow, we'll find it. Anywhere it gone, we will find it. Anybody else? Yeah, I see some people coming. Because you want to fix something. Proper attitude is what we're talking about. Thank you. Thank you. Proper attitude. I love you for your obedience. Just drop it. Put a thing here. Yeah. She's going to help me with it. Just drop it. Pastor, I you didn't ask me to do this, and I took the liberty to do it, and I'm just doing what God has led me to do. Thank you. Bring your checks. Bring the offering. If it's not you, don't worry about it. Don't fuss about it. Let those whom the Holy Spirit is speaking to, let them come. Let them come to the altar and do it. Appreciate you. Yeah, anybody else coming? I'm going to turn over to the pastor. Yeah, you're coming? Yeah, you can come right around. Praise God. Praise God. Now you can go home and have your dinner and feel good. and you can go over the harvest over there and feel good. Know that your attitude was sorted out. You never thought about it. Some of you never even remember that it is harvest today, and so you never planned to do anything. You know, a promissory note, Pastor, know your name and know who you are. Thank you, my son. God bless you. Shake my hand. You're a good man. God bless you. Anybody else coming? And we have machine around the back for those of you who only have cars. Just walk right there and you can go and deal with it. Praise God. That woman there look like Elaine Fuller. Same way she look. Like Elaine. I don't know if it's Elaine, but it look like Elaine. And me know that lady there. Same one. Come. Oh, yeah. All you too. Your face look familiar. Give it to me. You should have bring it long time. You know, look how long you hear me waiting for it. God bless you, Dad. Good to see you. Same one, I see you, man. Good people, them. Praise God. Stand with me, please. We're done. You're coming, sister? I mean, you're coming to me? Praise God. Oh, sorry to rush you so much here. Take your time. Come. Oh, I'll even meet you halfway. God bless you. Father, we lift up this offering before you. We thank you for those who have been obedient and who have chosen to honor you. Those who forgot that they were going to be a day of harvest. And those who decided, I'm not going to give, but they have decided to fix it. I pray that you'd bless this offering and the gifts and the givers. And bless this congregation and its leaders, the pastor, Dr. Knight, his family. God, I pray that you'd protect this congregation from the canker worm. Protect this congregation from the locust and from the devouring worm and locust. And I pray that you'd bless your people and let your people know that you are large and you are in charge. We honor and praise you, Father. We dedicate this offering to you now and we send it off to you with our praise in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Clap your hands for joy and send off this offering to the Lord. Praise God.
Thank you. Praise God. Amen. Be seated for a little while. We want to give God thanks for his word to our hearts today. Could you put your hands above your heads and give the Lord a hand clap? Hallelujah. Amen. And we want to appreciate the man of God, Bishop Vernon, for sharing with us in such an able way, such a powerful way, straight and direct from the throne of God. Would you put your hands together and appreciate the man of God? Praise God. Lots of nuggets in his delivery. Lots of takeaways in his delivery there for us, food for thought, for us to meditate and to leave from here and to put into practice. Amen. Praise the Lord. We continue to pray for him and his family, his children, and his grandchildren. We continue to pray for them. And even as the prayer ministry is covering him, I invite you to stretch your hands forward towards him and be praying God's blessing over him and his family. Cover your manservant, Father. Go before him. Go before his family. Surround them like a fire, O God, throughout the day and throughout the night. We pray that you keep them covered and sheltered under your everlasting wings, that the enemy will be able to do them no harm. Hallelujah. We speak into their lives today that the presence of God will continue to walk with them. Your power, your hand of provision and of grace and of mercy will rest upon your servant continually. We look to you today. We thank you for the word he has brought. We receive it with all our heart, O God, and we are committed to practicing the truth of God. We're committed, O God, to put into practice the words spoken through your servant today. Cover us, we pray, and cover your people. Cover your servant through Christ our Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Thanks again, Bishop Vernon. Thank you so much for availing yourself to be here today. We bless God that he has taken the time out to be with us. He could have been in any church in Jamaica today, but has chosen to act upon our invitation to bring the word to us today. Put your hands together again for this humble servant of God. Praise the Lord. Just before we dismiss, I want to thank you so much, all of you who have been supporting the ministry here. Thanks for your support to the convention on Monday. You'd have heard Sister Knight echoed that. I want to endorse that echo of thanks and appreciation to all of you who supported the convention on Monday, especially those who are on the ground, inside and outside. May the Lord bless you richly. I want to thank all of you who have brought your gifts to harvest today. May the Lord continue to add his richest blessings over your life. Praise God. As we go, I want to make mention and congratulate our young people. We have some results coming out of Congress. And you know, Bishop Vernon was the one who started, he's the brain child for and master for Congress. He started that initiative way back, 25 years ago as youth director. So coming out of Congress, we have in the children's category, the solo expressive dance. We were third place with that. Please put your hands together and appreciate our children. And for solo spoken word, we were first place. In the teens category, small group praise dance, we are second. Amen. And for, I think this is rap solo, first place. Come on, Old Harbor. Come on, come on. Boy, we sound dry. Even a drum roll would help us right now. We sound kind of dry. No, so? And then small group spoken word. We are first place. Wow. In sports, we are also the All-Island Youth Champions, under 15 football. Old Harbor, you think we're sick in here? No, man. And of course, the district was represented by Old Harbor Bay Church. You think we're sick in here? My God, look at this. Also, we want our good up district youth director, please to stand. Please to stand because you're looking right now at the most outstanding district youth director for the parish of St. Catherine, our youth director. Come on, give it up for her. Ah, wonderful, beautiful. Congratulations, ma'am. Congratulations to you and to the team and to all our young people here at Old Harbor and across the district. Congratulations. Praise God. Amen. Amen. Then I have a little bit, a piece more statistic for you. Let me get that here. Let me see if I can find that. I'm not so technologically savvy, but let me just paddle my way through. Great. Here we are with some more statistics for us. And we would have been getting our quarterly statistical report from the National Office, which is a strategic update. And for the past quarters, we have been well featured in that and have been doing very well. Amen, church? Yeah, man, you've been doing well. Praise God. And let me tell you something, church. Maybe we get so accustomed to hearing that we're not doing well and people just beating down on us and you must do this, do that, do that, do more, do more. No, come on. When you're doing well, don't be afraid to pat yourself on your shoulder and to say you're doing well and accept that you're doing well. Amen, somebody? The Lord does not always have a word of rebuke and reprimand. Sometimes he has a word of commendation for the church. Amen, somebody? But we just get so used to the rebuke. Come on. So I'm commending the church this morning that you've been doing well. So give yourselves a hand clap. Hallelujah. And so here we go. Strategic updates for the quarter ending February. That's December, January, February. And this strategic update features the top 10 churches in Jamaica. And you know we are 360-odd churches. And it features top 10. Here we go. Top 10 churches in tithes per capita. And we see Old Harbor here at number one. Amen. It's a little bit of what Vernon was alluding to earlier. And so you're no longer at number there, so you're at number one. Praise God. The top 10 churches in tithes for the quarter. Old Harbor, number three. No, man, you need to say louder than that. Because here what happened, the two churches that are before you are Portmore and Walton Park. No, they are the bigger churches. Then we go over to top 10 churches in offerings for the quarter. Offering for the quarter. Old Harbor, number one. That is a church that pays the most offering for the quarter. Now, you should say hallelujah. Top 10 churches in offerings per capita. And per capita means when you divide the offering by the number of members in the church. Old Harbor, number one. Then top 10 in the number of people baptized in water for the quarter. Old Harbor, number one. Top 10 churches in the number of people baptized in the Holy Ghost. Old Harbor, number two. Somewhere you need to fill if you are number one. But you must fill with the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Amen, amen, amen. Praise God. And top 10, no, we are not featured in the number of new members. Something went awry with that statistic there. But we'll get that sorted out. Amen. And so we have out of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 categories, the church is featured in 6 of those. And out of those 6, for 4 of those, you are at number one. Come on, you need to give God thanks. To God be the glory. Hallelujah. Great things he has done. Praise God. Joseph said, you meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. I want to thank all of you who continue to support this church and this ministry. May the Lord continue to bless you. May the Lord continue to give you strength and wisdom and vision. May the Lord continue to rest his hand upon you as you continue to support your church and the ministry. God bless you. Father, we present these emblems to you We pray, oh God, that each of these objects would be blessed and consecrated by your hand and by your glory. May your blood mix and mingle with it, Holy Spirit, that your people will find grace, victory, and deliverance by your hand through Jesus Christ, our Savior. The church say amen. 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 God bless you. May the Lord bless you richly. There are some, the harvest goodies that are by the convention center. Please feel free, pass by, buy out everything. Make sure you grab something before you leave. And we won't be here tonight for service. A number of people have been here throughout the week. People have been so exhausted. And so we won't be here for service tonight. We will be back, however, on Tuesday for fasting, Victory Fasting service. Sorry, Wednesday for Victory Fasting service and for Bible studies Wednesday evening at 7 o'clock. God bless you. Please have a wonderful and a productive week. All workers and pastors, please remember Saturday morning at 6:30. Infused into our prayer meeting will be pastors and workers fasting service right here at the Old Harbor Church in the sanctuary. It's so good to have Reverend Wilkes with us again. Praise God. She was with us last week. God bless you. Good to see you. Good to have you. God bless you richly. Please lift your hands and receive a benediction. And now may the saving grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, faithful fellowship and communion of the Holy Spirit the Comforter, rest, remain, and abide with us now and forevermore. Amen. Just before you go, we will be resuming construction.